Faith Christian Church. Please stand. We're going to worship the Lord together.
I'd ask you all to sit down for a moment if you're on site today. If you're home, you can sit down too, because I'm going to read some scripture for us this morning to start our service. The Bible tells us as believers, therefore, as God's chosen people, holy and dearly loved, clothe yourselves with compassion, kindness, humility, gentleness, and patience. Bear with each other and forgive one another. If any of you has a grievance against someone, forgive as the Lord forgave you. And over all these things, over all these virtues, put on love, which binds them all together in perfect unity. In 1 Corinthians chapter 9, verse 19 starts off, and he tells us about our position in Christ further. Though I am free, the Apostle Paul says, and belong to no one, I have made myself a slave to everyone to win as many as possible. To the Jews, I became like a Jew to win the Jews. To those under the law, I became like one under the law, though I myself am not under the law, so as to win those under the law. To those not having the law, I became like one not having the law, though I am not free from God's law, but am under Christ's law, so as to win those not having the law. To the weak, I became weak to win the weak. I have become all things to all people so that by all possible means I might save some. I do all this for the sake of the gospel that I may share in its blessing. This morning when I got up, I received a note on Twitter, a little tweet, and it said, believers, pastors in the house churches in Afghanistan are already receiving threats, death threats. I was on last month with 12 Iranian pastors, and we were zooming in where the government couldn't get in on our call. And for an hour, we got to share about ministry and the joys of ministry. I remember crying with three of them about the heartache of ministry as well. Right now, our brothers and sisters in Afghanistan who have turned to Christ in the last few years are now under terrible threat of life and death. And so we want to pray for them, especially this morning. We have such freedom in Christ. Mask or not, that's a small matter compared to what they're about to encounter, my friends. So we want to be in prayer, especially for the believers in Afghanistan this morning hour, what they're facing, how God might put his hand of mercy on them, strengthening their faith, and at the same time, protecting them from harm. Let's pray for them today. Father God, we come before you now. We have such a blessing. We have a great band. We have a great worship time together, praising you for all the things that you've done for us, creating in us a new heart, a holy people you call us because of what the Holy Spirit has done in our life, not because of what we've done. And so now, Lord, I pray that we might reflect upon that and pray earnestly. We pray for our brothers and sisters in Christ in Afghanistan. Protect them. Give them your hand of grace and mercy and love. I pray that you surround them with the work of the Holy Spirit to protect them and provide for them. I pray that you might bring them great comfort this morning hour, just as you bring us comfort in our dilemmas and in our problems. We pray this in the name of the Holy Spirit, who is changing our lives every moment of the day, in the great name of Jesus, who paid for our sins, and in your name, who planned it all and provided it all. In Christ's name we pray, amen. Hey, I just want to thank you for being with us today. So many of you on site, and if you're a first-time guest at the atrium, in the atrium afterwards at the desk, we have a special gift for you. I hope that you'll stop by and take advantage of that. If you're at home, hey, we'll be glad to send you a Bible if you need a Bible. We'll send you other literature if you want it. Just text us and let us know any concerns, any points of interest, maybe prayer for you. We'll be glad to do that for you. So glad that you're joining us online. But so many of us are here today. It's a great day to praise the Lord. We have two things coming up in our experience here at Living Faith. Number one, we have our fall picnic, or our summer picnic, I guess it is, because the fall's not here yet, on August 28th at Bethpage State Park. You can pick up literature about that, a card that will tell you about the time of it and all, and what to bring. And that's out in the atrium on your way out the door as well. I'd like to encourage you to keep coming and seeing what God will do in your life. And you know, one of the things he can do in your life is to provide a backpack for a child to go to school, because only 61% of the kids in Hempstead graduate from high school. That's a pretty low number. And you know something? We've got a guy there who provides backpacks for the kids. And as he does at the ABBA ministry, I have been there handing those backpacks out, watching those kids beam when they get it, because they wouldn't have had the opportunity to go to school with anything like that. So you can help, and we have a bin outside. You can drop those off in the next week or so. And until the 23rd, I believe it is, we'll take those. Glad to have you help in that way. Hey, I'd like to mention two people. We've got a guy who joined our staff recently as ministry resident, and Manny Fernandez, I want you to stand. We want to welcome him to staff. It's a blessing. Thank you, Manny. We've got him running around doing a lot of things right now. He just graduated from Liberty in ministry apologetics. So if you want to know God's word, how to defend your faith, there's the guy that can help you. Going to start study soon in the Master Divinity program. And then Stephen Kwachi is here from Ghana, West Africa, one of our missionaries. We want to welcome you to our service as well. It's good to have you home, and you want to keep in prayer for Lucy, his wife. She's been undergoing cancer treatment for several months now, and so here on Long Island, he's back with her. It's so good to be back with your wife, isn't it, and your family, and we want to keep in prayer for them. Thank you for being with us today. Why don't you stand now and prepare to continue to worship as Brad and the band lead us.
Who the sun? the goodness of God. And all my life you have been faithful. And all my life you have been so, so good. With every breath that I am able, oh, I will sing of the goodness.
We sing of your goodness. We give you praise and we give you glory today. Lord, you are the one and the only true King. And as Pastor Mark mentioned earlier, what an amazing privilege we have to come before you and the freedom to do that in this place today, Lord. So we thank you for that amazing blessing that we have, that we can gather together and lift our voices to you, Lord. And also, it's amazing that you would choose to call us your children. You, the King, the one true King, would call us child and be so good to us. We thank you for all the blessings that you've bestowed upon us, Lord, and the way you've worked in our lives. And we ask now that you would speak to us, Lord, speak to us through Pastor Mark as he delivers your word to us. Speak to us through the message and through your word. Continue to mold us, Lord God, so that we can continue to go out and be a light in the world for you. It's our desire to give you the glory and the honor. We pray this in the mighty name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated.
Amen. Please have a seat. Hey, if you're here on site, turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. If you're at home, get your Bible out. Turn to 2 Corinthians chapter 5. I'm going to read it in a minute. Hey, it's an exciting day. It's always exciting to be here at Living Faith because I see God's hand and his activity. I just see so much outreach, so much growth here in people and in our congregation in many ways. Matter of fact, last Thursday, a guy called me out of Michigan, and an elder in a church there, and he out of the blue, and he said, "Hey, could you tell me how you do evangelism? Because we're not very good at it." You know what I said to him? "Get on your knees, brother, because you need to make it part of your DNA that you're calling upon God Almighty to change a heart, a life, your heart and your life first, so that you can communicate that to others." He's a good brother in Christ. He took that to heart. I'll probably be talking to him some more. But you know something? When I say we call upon God, it's part of our DNA. It was exciting because I went out after the service, this past first service, and I was out in the hallway by the elevator. I'd walked out, got some water to refill the bottle. And as I was walking back, a lady came up to me and she said, "Hi, Pastor, this is my first time here." I said, "Well, that's wonderful." I said, "Are you coming in or are you going out for the service, you know?" And she said, "I'm going out. I just left the service." We began to talk, and she told me she's from Babylon and told me what she's going through and why she came to our church, just because a friend or a relative invited her. And I said to her, "Well, what's your background, spiritual background?" She told me it was a traditional Orthodox type church and how she went there as a young person and then as an older person changed to a different church, but very similar. And then I said to her, "Well, can I tell you my background?" She said, "Sure." And I told her how I came to Christ as a boy, how God had changed my heart, how John 1:12 had entered into my life, and I received the Lord. I said, "One night I'm sitting there all by myself and memorizing John 1:12, and I said, but as many as received him, and I looked up. I remember sitting there in October. I won't tell you what year, how old I am, but I was sitting there, and I looked up, and I said, wait a minute. I go to church all the time. I mean, my father got saved, my mom, and they go, these are Baptist people, you know, they're old time. They go Sunday school, Sunday morning and Sunday night and Wednesday night, and my dad was a youth group director. I'm pretty sure we got involved in a church pretty heavily, right? And so I said, I go to church, and I believe in God, I believe in Jesus. I'm a good boy, doing everything I'm supposed to do, but I've never received Christ." That was right there in the verse, embedded. And I said, and so that night I bowed my head and I said, "Lord Jesus, forgive me for my sins. Come into my life." I made it personal with God. I got serious that night. And I never looked back. I told her that. She looked at me and I said, so when did you receive Christ? Like that. And a tear came to her face and she said, I never had. And I said, "I don't know if it's okay, but would you like to receive Christ in front of an elevator right here out in the hallway in an atrium and pray with me?" And she said, "I would like to do that." I said, "Does that make sense to you?" She said, "Yes, it does. I've never done that. Never had known Christ as Savior like that." Right there in the hallway, I pulled one of the ushers in. Our missionary was with us. I pulled him in. And she just out loud prayed and received Christ as Savior. I've got to tell you something. I never know what to expect, and I never know who's watching at home right now saying, "You know, it's something, I believe in God, I believe all about it, it's good, the church is good, I give to organizations, I believe in God and Jesus, but I've never received Christ as Savior." If you're at home right now, or if you're in here, and you're in that case, you need to trust in Christ, because when you do, you'll never look back again. Because you'll know you're in the Lord. You'll know that your faith in Christ has set you free and it's transformed and changed you. Don't put it off any longer. But you know, I've seen this happen in our church over and over again. I never thought it would happen in front of the elevator like that. But you know something? That's the way God works, doesn't he? He just steps into it. And he steps into it through you and me. He wants to use us. I never led a soul to Christ till I was 26 years old. I was always trying to prove my point, but never bring them to Jesus. And when I learned that you can bring people to Jesus, God began to use me just like he's used so many of you in the same way. Now, while we have less people attending our church because of coronavirus and people are watching from home, over 1,000 people, did you know over 1,000 people watch every Sunday morning alone at home or somewhere, maybe in their car or on vacation, wherever they happen to be? And then you guys are here this morning to praise the Lord, to worship him. You can do it in either place, but we're so glad to have you here. But we're seeing God move. I think since January 1st, we tapped our computer. We've had around 2,000 different people attend our church since January 1st. Did you know that, you know, coronavirus, nobody wants to go to church, right? Over 840 first-time guests have come to this church since September 27th last year. I'm always amazed by that, right? Here's why they come, because they're longing to know the God of all the universe, the King himself. And they know they can find him, because he says, if you seek the Lord, he shall be found. And I'm always excited to see that. But few of us thought it would happen. As a matter of fact, last year we were spinning our wheels just trying to get online so that this church could be together, at least in some form or not. It's hard to predict how God will move. Never underestimate, you've heard me say it before, never underestimate a work of the Holy Spirit in any situation. Our brothers and sisters in Afghanistan are going to undergo moments of terrorizing fear. God will be with them. He will show them how to carry themselves through it, and he will carry them along. Do you remember when you first came to Christ? You think back for a moment. Some of you are first-generation Christians. That is, your parents weren't believers in Christ, and you're the first one in the family, maybe, or it was a first for you because your parents didn't teach you that. And you remember what it was like. Some of you were probably scared. You're thinking, okay, if I receive Christ as Savior, do I have to go to church every week? Right? And you're wondering, maybe I have to tithe. I've heard that word before. What if they want my money? What if God wants my time? What if he wants my talent? What if I've got to do something more? And so there's all kinds of things that become barriers for us, cause us to resist God's Spirit when he comes for us. But remember when you came to Christ? How relieved you were. Your sins were gone. Heaven awaited you. God would be with you from day to day. You'd be learning the scriptures, transformed and changed and renewed. Some of you would look back 2 years, 5 years, 8 years ago, you say, I never thought I'd be like this now. I never knew the joy that I would have of knowing the Savior. I remember when my dad told me the story about how he got saved, and then he said a week later when he told my mom I trusted in Christ to save her, he was fearful of her, but she actually got excited. Because she said, I saw such a change in your life. I knew something happened. She said, give me a chance to think about it. 2 weeks later, she received Christ as Savior. See, that's what God does. He changes. And he does it in spite of a pandemic. He does it in spite of a nasty workplace. He does it in spite of terrible neighbors. Hopefully you aren't one of those. But those other guys, you know, it's always the other guys on the other side of that fence. This is how it is. We kind of diss God and we start thinking, God, you really aren't going to do a work. God, what's the situation like? I want to remind you that God can move any way he likes, any day, at any time, and he'll change a heart, and he'll renew you in spirit and pick you up, because it's the grace of God that's just extended into your life and into your heart. Never underestimate how God might work. But the day in the life of a disciple, what it's like then, what did God call us to? 2 Corinthians chapter 5, rather, beginning of verse 11. I'll just read the passage, and I want to point out three. You know, a good preacher points out three things. So I'm going to point out three things to you in the passage, three key thoughts here. Verse 11, I'm going to read it for you. Since then, we know what it is to fear the Lord. We try to persuade others. What we are is plain to God, and I hope it's also plain to your conscience. Verse 12, we're not trying to commend ourselves to you again, but are giving you an opportunity to take pride in us so that you can answer those who take pride in what is seen rather than in what is in the heart. If we are out of our mind, as some say, it is for God. If we are in our right mind, it is for you. For Christ's love compels us, because we are convinced that one died for all, and therefore all died. And he died for all, that those who live should no longer live for themselves, but for him who died for them and was raised again. Verse 16. So from now on, we regard no one from a worldly point of view. Though we once regarded Christ in this way, we do so no longer. And this key verse, you ought to memorize this verse. Verse 17, therefore, if anyone is in Christ, then the new creation has come. The old has gone, the new is here. All this is from God, who reconciled us to himself through Christ and gave us the ministry of reconciliation, that God was reconciled the world to himself in Christ, not counting people's sins against them, and he has committed to us the message of reconciliation. We are therefore Christ's ambassadors. As though God were making his appeal through us, we implore you on Christ's behalf, be reconciled to God. Verse 21, the final one. God made him who had no sin to be sin for us, so that in him we might become the righteousness of God. There are three key thoughts here in this passage for us to understand about being a disciple. And the first one is, their lives were a convincing, or, and the verse uses persuade in the first verse in verse 11, but it's the idea of convincing display of God's power or activity to change. You see, that's what God wants in us. He's going to use us, reform us, change us, design us in a new, and shape us in a new and fresh way, so that we display the glory of God to our neighbors, friends, and colleagues. A different kind of way to thinking. It is God who changes and empowers the person. Now, if we go back to the book of Acts, in the book of Acts, the word persuade is used six times, the Greek word there, and what it has the idea of is persuading lost people to come to know Christ as Savior. Let me tell you something. You want to be a part of that. Don't miss the boat on being used of God to lay it out before a person and draw them to know the Lord. But in this passage, what he's saying, rather than persuade, it's convincing them and showing them and revealing the glory of God to fellow believers, so that they walk stronger in the Lord, they walk stronger in his grace, and are more confident of a work of God. Because when you see a life that's changed, when you see God using that person, oh man, there's something about that lighthouse out there that just beams forth the glory of God. It is God who changes and empowers that person, by the way. It is not you. The more you strive, the more you try, what happens? The more you fail, right? That's what it seems to happen. That's why when I said to the fella last Thursday night, I said, get on your knees and ask God to change your DNA, because you can't do it. I know people would love to win their spouse to Christ, others to Christ. My neighbors, my friends, my coworkers. It's not going to happen until you ask God's Spirit to move through you into their lives. And God will bless you and uniquely transform you into his son's image as we lean into the Holy Spirit. And he'll use us in ways that maybe not winning somebody to Christ, but displaying his glory and beaming forth the message of the gospel. In Philippians chapter 2:13 says, for it is God who works, that's an energy, the idea of energy, in you to will and to act according to his good purpose. God is doing that. He's busy doing that. He wants to use you, and it's he that is doing it. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 14, right here, you'll notice what it says. It says, for Christ's love compels us. And so the idea is that we are motivated by what Christ has done, and as we do, it displays forth the glory of God. We go from being persecutors, haters of the gospel, to lovers of the gospel, people who are joyful in Christ. And some of you are like that. I knew some of you before you were saved. You're pretty nasty people. But I remember when you came to Christ, and all of a sudden, the guard went down, and God did a great thing in your life and in your heart. We go from dreading death to anticipating the life that God brings into us. So that's the first thing is, God is convincing the world and convincing believers especially of the change and transformation that's in our hearts, and we display that in the glory of God. Number two, their lives were new in verse 17. If anyone's in Christ, it's a new creation. You remember what it was like before you came to Christ? Lost, wondering, how will I make ends meet? Yelling and screaming at other people, frustrated with them because those nasty people out there, it's always them, you know, the other side of the fence. We're frustrated because we didn't know how to get along in life, full of anxiety, full of tension, having no peace. And when Christ comes into life, he says, the old, trusting in myself, have moved away from, and now I've got something new. It's the work of the Spirit who's transformed me and changed me and renewed my heart toward God. And thus, I can know the will of God. Did you know you can know the will of God? Yeah. You know why? Because the Spirit of God is in you if you're a believer in Jesus. And you can trust in him and ask him to bring you new insight, new understanding all the time. That's why I like to gather around other Christians sometimes. I just like to hear what God's doing in their life, because all of a sudden I sit there and I go, wow, I never thought that thought before. Thank you. And the Holy Spirit will use another believer around me to bring me that insight. That's why small groups are so important. When it comes time to sign up for them next month, let me encourage you. Get alongside of a small group. It'll encourage you, build you up, and challenge you in fresh and new ways. But their lives were new. Galatians 2:20 says, I'm crucified with Christ, yet not I, but Christ lives in me. In the life I live in the flesh, I live by the faith of the Son of God who loves me and gave himself for me. You got a new life in Jesus, a new transformation, a new way to walk. And so we open our eyes and we say, God, reveal yourself to me and cause me to be new and fresh. That's what I expect when I come to Jesus. That's what I expect when a person trusts in him. There was nothing reflecting the old. He's saying it's all new. The works of the flesh are gone, and the ministry of the Spirit is now. And that's what he's describing for us here in this passage, that all things are new. And some of you, your problem is you're sitting in the old still, trying to understand what the new is about. And you need to remove yourself sometime and cast yourself in God's people. Get alongside them. If you're out there watching on camera, may I encourage you once in a while, at least come to church. Sit with other believers. Let them encourage you and build you up in the Lord. It's a great thing in Christ. Number three, the third point in this passage he makes is this. He says, we are ambassadors of Christ. Their focus was now only what Christ desired. Over in Afghanistan today, can you imagine being the ambassador to Afghanistan for the last few years? You've challenged the people, cared for them, helped them, tried to build them up, tried to do everything you could for them, and now you're seeing the country fall to the Taliban and fall apart. Your heart has to be broken, and you're going to get on a helicopter, and you're going to fly out of the country soon. But no matter how hard and no matter what you want to do for those people, you have to follow your boss's orders. And that is to leave the country. And you know something? If that's what it is, it's what it is. And the same thing is true in our lives. Christ has given us some commands, and we follow those commands because we're ambassadors for Christ. And that's why it's so important to study God's word so that we get it right. I've heard so much bad theology. You've heard it too. You know, God is, one that always irritates me. We all say it sometimes. God is three parts. Father, Son, Holy Spirit. He isn't three parts. He's three persons. There's a big difference between three parts. You got to study your words so you're able to articulate it well, because people get confused after a while. Three different pieces of God, I guess. No, it's one God, three persons. We got to understand our theology and understand our doctrines, because it has implications in how we're going to live. But we're ambassadors. We speak what he wants us to speak. Everything we say now then goes to what? He says he has given us the ministry of reconciliation, going out and pulling people to Christ, not to our political party, not to our discernment about masks or no masks, not getting people angry at the workplace over stupid stuff all over the place, whether the paper clips are the right size or not. Some of you know what I'm talking about. We get upset about a lot of things. What we ought to be focused on is what Christ wants, and what he wants is us to preach the gospel that people can come to know him and be set free from their sins. And that is our beeline. That's our focus we're to follow at all times. Following Christ. In 1 Corinthians 10:31, it says this, we're to do all things to what? The glory of God. everything focuses on what he's called us to do, to follow him and to preach the word of God. Now, Christ gave two orders. You know that, right? He gave two orders before he left. Matthew 28, he told us what? Go into all the world and preach the gospel and make disciples, baptizing them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. What are we to do? We're to go out and call people to be reconciled to God, to know Christ as Savior and know his forgiveness. That's our job. That's what he's called us to do. And you know something? Can I stop here for a second? He called us to make disciples, followers of God, who reproduce themselves. That's what he's calling us to do. And you don't do that when you don't get baptized. Now, that's stunning for a second. Some of you are saying, wow, I've put off being baptized. I mean, it's an optional thing, right? Jesus said, go into all the world, preach the gospel, make disciples, and baptize them in the name of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. If you want God's blessing, but you refuse to follow his orders, you got a problem. And then you wonder, God, why aren't you helping me with my finances? Why does my car keep breaking down? Why is this happening? Why is that happening? Why are my relationships broken? Why can I not convey the gospel well? Maybe it's because I'm not obeying him and being baptized. So that's my sidebar for you today in the area of baptism. Hey, guy came up to me after the service. He said, I'm so glad you mentioned that. My daughter said, Dad, I ought to be baptized. That was good to hear after the service. So the first service, hey, I just want to encourage you. It's a great thing because you know what? It's like a barrier. You know, between you and God, once you get past that barrier, you go, wow, I'm free. Man, Jesus, what do you got next for me? And that's what happens in our life as we take steps over time. And God knows you need to take those steps, and he knows that it's hard sometimes to take those steps because there are barriers all around us, things that get in our way along that. But Jesus tells us, number one, to go out into all the world, and number two, he tells us another thing. First, the Great Commission, that's what it's called in Matthew 28, go into all the world. The second one is the Great Commandment given in the Gospel of John, and that says what? We're to love one another, just as he had love for us. You know how much love he had for us? He went to the cross for us. So I would say to you this, is how much love should you have for another person? Another person who offends you, another person who you don't like, another person who's just in the way. God wants us always to love other people, and the greatest love you can have is to share the gospel with them. Let them know that Jesus changed your life. Be that display of God's glory that God has changed you and continues to change you. So I ask this question, as I think that through though, we've got these three things. We've got to be that display of God's love. Number two, our lives are new, and we have a ministry of reconciliation. But then if I've got all that, and I know the command to go, and I know the command to love, why am I so bad at it? Isn't that the way it feels sometimes? Why aren't we more effective in sharing Christ as our Savior? And I think there's a couple of reasons. Let me just share these with you. Number one, I think that sometimes we just want to get other people on the team with us. We have so much ownership in Christ, so much ownership in our church. I mean, some of you show up before the pastor shows up here on a Sunday morning because you're so anxious to be around other Christians. The church has changed your life, and the gospel has changed your life. And so we're excited about it. Nothing wrong with that. But sometimes we're like multi-level marketers, you know? We're so convinced this is the best plan in the world. Come to our church. Come with me. This will bring you success. Or come join our club. We used to joke about the church being a Christian club sometimes because only the club members came. We couldn't get people who needed Christ to come. I'm so glad that that isn't happening here. I see so many people who are fresh and new and just say, hey, I just was wondering. Matter of fact, a lot of people see the sign out front as they drive down Hempstead and they say, I just came in because I wanted to see what this is all about. And so sometimes we're pushing the church more than we're pushing Jesus. I think there's also, we try to get people to think like us, you know? We want them to think the right way, right? We want them all to be Republicans. We want them all to be Democrats. We want them to all be, you see, and we think like that in every area of our life, and so then we take it into the gospel and we say, got to make them think like us. Doctrinally, they got to think like us. They got to be the kind of Christian like us. You know, and all of a sudden, we're making people move down the road rather quickly rather than drawing them to Christ and letting Christ change their lives. We care more about the truth than their souls. And I'll be honest with you, I've seen this and I've experienced it. I remember Lewiston, Maine. I think I told the story before. In Lewiston, Maine, I'm walking down the street and I'm handing out gospel tracts. I'm 19 years old. I'm just on fire for Jesus. I don't know any better. I've memorized a dozen, two dozen, 50 verses, 100 verses. I don't know, a lot of verses in my life, and I'm ready to go. So I'm walking down the street with my friend Milton, and he thinks I'm a little cuckoo, crazy, but I'm handing out gospel tracts to everybody. And this one guy, I handed it to him. Isn't that funny? I remember that all the way back to 19 years old. I went and handed it to him. He said, no. And he was kind of abrupt with me, kind of gruff. And I said, no, sir, this is the gospel. Change your life. No. And I said, but you got to take it. No. And he wouldn't take it. And as he walked away, I said, okay, then go to hell. That probably wasn't my best witnessing moment. You see, I cared more about the truth of God's word than I cared about that man's soul. That was the problem. And if we're not careful, we want to promote and push Jesus without them being like their lives being changed and enjoying the work of the Lord. And then we don't think like them. Sometimes we've lost our unsaved edge, okay? Did you know that after 3 years of being a Christian, a study in the 80s found, after 3 years of being a Christian, you know hardly anyone on a personal level, intimately, as a close friend anymore, who's lost. And then after 5 years, you pretty much cut off all your unsaved friends, people who are not Christians. And the reason is partially just part of the way the flow of life is. You know, I don't want to party with the friends at the barroom anymore. I don't want to go to the tailgate party where everybody's drunk and punching people. And I don't want to be a part of this or a part of that anymore. So we kind of cut ourselves off. But as we cut ourselves off, as we withdraw, I should say, we end up cutting ourselves off from those people who desperately need to hear the love of God. Wouldn't it be great to be at a tailgate party where everybody's getting drunk except you? And you say, I'll have another Coke, please. And that's Coca-Cola, not Coke and the other word. And all of a sudden, people are looking at you going, why are you like that? I said, Christ changed me so much. I just want to keep my mind straight for him. I want to give him glory. I want to go into the stadium and praise God for a guy who can catch a football instead of just shouting and yelling at him in a vulgar way. You see, that's what Christ does for us. He changes us. And sometimes we cut ourselves off. We forget to recall how dead in our sins we were. Ephesians chapter 2, verse 2. You who were once dead in your transgressions. And say, how dead were we? You throw the lifeline out to a person who's floating on the water, dead, and they can't grab the lifeline. That's how dead we were before we came to Christ. We had nothing in ourselves to save us, nothing in ourselves to keep us. And we had to come to Jesus on his terms completely. So we sometimes have fears and we change the change that's been brought into our lives. We have conflict, defiance of the soul. We just hate to be around it. And maybe God has another way for us, a caring biblical approach to others, of knowing our audience. You remember Jesus, what he did though? He sat with what? Sinners. That's right. Now, he didn't sit around and sin with them. It just said he was around with them. See, because the sinners wanted to hear transformational living, kingdom living. Sadducees, Pharisees didn't want to hear that. So they didn't want to be around him. He knew their intentions. He knew their condition. He knew their desires, whether they liked to cook, sports, whether they liked to fish, no matter what it was. He knew them intimately, but he hung around with them. The apostles knew their audience, and they thought like Jews. And what did they do? They went to a Jewish audience, and they appealed to them based on something they could relate to. Jesus did the same thing when he was there at their meals. Paul knew his audience. He went to Jews and Greeks, and he transitioned his arguments based on his audience. But he took that to the audience there. I would say this to you. You know your audience better than you think, because you were once one of them. If you've come to Christ, there are people who need to know you care. They need lots of attention. That's the unfortunate part. Lost people need lots of attention because it may take them a while to come to Jesus. Remember you? Some of you say, well, it took me 3 years, 4 years, 5 years to come to Christ. Show the other people some grace that it may take a while for them to come to know him. And they need to be the focus, not the target of our preaching, the focus, the love of Christ to share with them. So how can we be more effective? I have thought about four ways we can be more effective. First of all, if you want to write this down, we must encourage them to own the gospel themselves. Let them come on their own terms. Let them see that they need and they want the gospel of Christ. Be self-compelled. Otherwise, they turn away later. Remember what Jesus did with the scribe? He's talking to a scribe, and the scribe says, oh, I think I know what it is to love the Lord your God with all your heart, soul, and mind, and to love your neighbor as yourself. And Jesus said this in Matthew 12:34, you are not far from the kingdom. You see, he went to them. He understood. He didn't condemn him and say, yeah, but you still haven't received Christ as Savior. You know, you still haven't gone and walked according to the kingdom rules. He didn't do that. He said, you're close. You're getting there. I sense it. I remember when I was in the basement of my house once, a little extra here, with three Jehovah's Witness ladies came to my house. And we stepped in. I had a nice basement room, and we stepped down, and I had a nice whiteboard. Oh, that was perfect. And so one of my members of my church said, the pastor will talk to you. So he brought these three Jehovah's Witnesses. That was nice of him to let me be the person to defend the faith, right? Please don't do that to me, okay? That's just never fun to engage with people who really didn't want to engage with you. And so we went through things, and I kept sharing Christ with them, kept sharing the blood of Christ, kept sharing with them that Jesus is God. And at one point, this girl's named April. I still pray for her occasionally when I recall her name. And I remember her looking at me. She said this, I think I now understand what you're talking about. And I looked at her, now that I think about Jesus' words, and I said, April, I think you do. You're close. You need to come to Christ. You see, that's the gentle spirit that we need to have. We need to encourage them to come to Jesus, not force it up on them, to change them, to get them to do it. I find that when God is at work, he doesn't stop, and he doesn't need our help. Remember Acts chapter 16? There's a verse there, it's Acts 16:5. It says, Lydia, the seller of purple, this is a King James version for you, people with the King James hang up. King James, it says this, Lydia, the seller of purple, whose heart the Lord opened. It's God who opens the heart. Paul didn't say, and Cornelius or anybody with him didn't say, oh, well, you know, we were able to lead this woman to Christ. He went to the banks of a river for a prayer time there, and this woman, Lydia, walked over, and somehow they shared the gospel, and Lydia received Christ. Probably never expected that. But see, it's God who reaches in, touches the heart, manifests himself to them, and then they come to Christ. Now, God uses you and he uses me, but it's God who opens the heart, just as the woman who was in the hallway earlier today. I would say this, let God do the work, but at the same time, don't miss the opportunity to share Christ and then watch God at work so that they're drawn to Christ without your efforts, but it's the work of the Holy Spirit drawing them, and they own the gospel. Number two, we must let them become familiar with Christ. They need to see Jesus. In John 13:25, it says, you'll be known by the way you what? Have love for one another. The way we care for other people, lost and saved, that matters the most. Listen, I have some doctrinal beliefs about when Christ is coming again, but so do some other Christians, and they don't agree with me on that. And you know what? I'm not going to get hung up on it, because I need to love my brothers and sisters in Christ no matter what. We need to draw close to one another, and people will see the love of Christ as we bear witness of that, as we display the glory of God, as that passage earlier had said. And people are won by love. They're not won by our harshness or by our preaching, quite frankly. My father used to say, and it wasn't his saying, he used to say, your actions speak so loud that I can't hear what you're saying. That's when I didn't want to mow the lawn, I guess. But they're won by your love, by your care, compassion. Right now, many people have bad feelings toward Christians everywhere. That's a fact. Some are watching online, and they've been having a tough time in their church. With some of the preaching, some of the teaching, some of the politics that have gone on in the past year. And a lot of people aren't listening to Christians very much anymore, and they're angry at us. And you know something? We need to rebuild some bridges by saying to them, I love you. And even in my disconnect with their underlying thoughts in life, I can still love someone and care for them. I can still bring them food. I can still show them the love of Christ in multiple ways. And we must do that. We must let them become familiar with Christ, and that is through our lives. They need to know we care beyond winning them. I want to win people to Christ, but I want them to know that I care about them as well. And the more you care about people, the more they'll know the Jesus that lies within you. Number three, we must take away uncertainty from people. They need time to process. Do you remember when you came to Christ? There were barriers up, right? If I go, I got to go to church. I don't know how to pray, right? Lady in the hall said to me, I said, do you pray much? She said, no, not at all. I said, okay, can I pray with you? And I'll lead you in prayer. You see, people don't know how to pray. So if you're going to ask them to come to Jesus, how can they come to Jesus if they don't know how to pray? See, it's a barrier. There are all kinds of barriers out there for them. And sometimes we make it an all or nothing type of thing with Jesus. It isn't. Let them taste and see, the psalmist says in Psalm 34:8, taste and see that the Lord is good. In Jeremiah 33:3, he says this, call unto me and I'll answer you and show you great and mighty things that you don't know. When we come to Christ, there's more that we don't know than what we do know. And we've got to bear witness to that. And we must take away, help take away the uncertainty and clarify things along the way. I remember Dean in my church, he was a hockey player up in Connecticut. And he came to our church for 3 months. Something was blocking the way. I don't know what it was. We preached the gospel. He heard it every week. He'd come with his wife. And finally, one day he said to me, you know something, I love to play hockey. I play it every Sunday morning, as you know, and I come to the church service. If I come to Christ, do you think I got to come to Sunday school too? See, we had Sunday school for adults and then service, and the good Christians, of course, always came to Sunday school, and the lesser ones always came just to church. That's a joke, folks, okay? But he had an uncertainty. If I come to Jesus, he had a problem with that. He had a barrier, and we took that barrier down, and I said, you know what? I don't think you're going to be playing hockey all your life. And furthermore, I think it's okay that if you get a chance just to be around other people and play some hockey and come to church and Bible study if you want to late, it's okay. And then I remember him coming to Christ. Number four, we must share with them the proof they're seeking. We need to get to know their questions and their objections. You know, we often think, well, this guy is not coming to Jesus because of this or because of that. It may not be at all. They may be more ready than you think, and they may have more objections and things than you think. And sometimes we're trying to defend the faith when they aren't even attacking it. Sometimes we're trying to give them answers that they're not even asking questions to. And so we need to understand that. 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 15 says, always be prepared to give an answer to any man who asks you about the hope that is within you. That is, we do need to know God's word. We need to study it. We need to prepare our hearts because they may ask you, where in the Bible does it say? And of course, the great answer is, I don't know, but I'll find it for you. Okay? It does work, by the way, because you can look it up. But we should study God's word and be prepared and answer the questions they're seeking, not the questions we're proposing to them. We need to be listen for keen insight that will build a bridge rather than to attack them or to defend our faith. We need to identify and reveal that. Show them who Jesus is. Help them to understand the questions that they're asking. I remember Dean, finally he came to me and he said, Mark, and he says, I'm ready. He walked in one Sunday night, president of a company, after attending 3 months, and I said, I wasn't going to let him off like that. I said, what are you ready for, Dean? And he looked at me and says, I'm ready to receive Christ as Savior. I said, Dean, get down on your knees. You see, all of a sudden, he had removed barriers. He had come to church. He had heard the message. He had the answers that he was looking for. He felt comfortable, and he wanted to buy into the gospel, not me buying in for him. When you lay back, sometimes you just wait for the Spirit of God. And I will tell you, sometimes I do that. Sometimes I just step back, and I watch people. And when I'm talking to them, and I say, and I ask the question, God, what are you doing in this man's heart right now? You got to ask that. Ask the Lord to show you what's happening in the scenario, the situation you're in. It's exciting to watch that. I remember 1986, as I conclude. 1986, I was given an impossible task. I became pastor of a church, 28 years old, never pastored before, had been a lead deacon in a church, served in a church, told people that they're going to hell in a church before, going back to that Lewiston joke. That's the way I was. And I thought, how can I ever do this? But I became the seventh pastor in a church that was 25 years old. All six pastors before me, for lack of a better word, had failed. Three of them had split the church at three different times. And then three of them had been pushed out of the church. And then those three different times. And I'm coming in at 28 years old. I'm thinking, God, you're going to use me great, right? Well, I'm kind of worried about it a little bit because pastors came to me and said, now don't expect too much, Mark, because this is going to be a tough work. And I was offended by that a little bit. You know why? Because I thought about the power of God to change a life, to change a church, change a people. And here's what I did. I spent the next 7.5 years working every day, every week, 53.5 hours every week. But additionally, here's the key. I got down on my knees for 45 minutes every morning, and I cried out to God, God, would you save some people? God, would you move in this person's heart? God, would you move in my life? God, would you show me the sermon for this Sunday morning, a sermon for Sunday night, a message for Wednesday night Bible study, and help me to prepare for Thursday night Awana Club. Pretty active. And you know something? God opened hearts. He opened a lot of hearts. Salvation always works that way with God. We saw the church go from 19 people to 80 to over 100 to over 200 to over 300 to over 400. Similar way that this is happening here in lives. I'm so thrilled to be a pastor in this church because I see it in the DNA. I see it in us saying, God, use us as you will. And that's what he wants from us. Expect God to work. Know you're called to work. And then may I say, because God opens the heart, watch God work. Vance Havner, I've said it before, said this, we're just one beggar showing another beggar where to find bread. So I tell you today, go show people the bread. Let's pray. Father, we want to display the glory of God as found in this passage, showing the love of Christ to brothers and sisters in the Lord and make it glow out into our community. Reveal that in us, work in our hearts and our lives. And then, Father, we would also pray, Lord, not just stopping there, but reminding us to renew our spirit daily because we are a new creation and we give ourselves over to you. And then, Father, we thank you for the ministry of reconciliation that you have changed our lives and given us a new direction. We're ambassadors for Christ. Remind us, Lord, to go into the world and remind us to love others as much as you've loved us. And we thank you for these things in Jesus' name. Amen.
Please stand and worship with us.
How great the chasm that lay between us. How high the mountain I could not climb. In desperation, I turned to heaven and spoke your name into the night. Then through the darkness, your loving kindness tore through the shadows.
the morning that sealed the promise, your buried body began to breathe.
Amen.
And out of silence, the roaring lion declared, the grave has no claim on me.
Wonderful, Brad and Ben, thank you so much for leading us in worship that way today. Hey, listen, if you're at home right now, you're on the road, wherever you happen to be, we're so glad that you joined us online. Would you just check off some boxes, let us know you're there, and would you let us know a prayer request, anything that we can help you with? Maybe you need to know Christ as Savior. Give the church a call. Let us know. We'll talk to you about that. And the rest of us, hey, out in the atrium, there's so many of you here today. So glad to see you. Out in the atrium, if you're a first-time guest, why don't you stop by, and they have a special gift for you. But we're so glad to have you with us because the grace of God has been so good to us. Now we'll go forth and show that to the rest of the world. Thanks for being with us. God bless you in the coming days ahead. Serve the Lord this week. Show him the bread. God bless you.